Good afternoon, everyone. I hope my voice is clear to you all and my screen is visible.
Yeah,
me a confirmation. Okay, yeah. Thanks a lot for the confirmation. Okay, so we'll start with the session. So I'll start with my introduction. I'm your host for the event. Myself, Rupesh. I'm the digital strategist working with Synergetics. So today's, I want to welcome you all for today's session that is on DP100 certification, designing and implementing in data science solution on Azure. So before moving into the event, so I want to give you a quick introduction about Synergetics. So Synergetics is a company whose core strength are rescaling and onboarding. We are a customized learning solution company, primarily working with B2B and B2C segments. So our key strengths are persona-based onboarding solutions, rescaling solutions, certification solutions, emerging technology trainings, cloud adoption solutions, and practice developments. So today's session is introduced by Azure Tech Community and sponsored by Synergetics and Microsoft. So people who are interested in cloud tech. Hello.
Yes, yeah. Your screen is not moving.
Screen is not moving. Just a moment. Let me just share it once again.
Please share it, please.
Is it visible now?
Yes, it's visible.
And please confirm if it is changing.
Yep.
Yeah, it is changing,
right? Okay, great. Please let me know if there's any issue with the slides and all and voice. Okay, please. So I was talking that our community is open for all the people who are interested in cloud Microsoft cloud technologies, along with the emerging technologies like artificial intelligence, machine learning, big data, analytics, IoT, cloud, and many more. So all you have to do is just to install a Meetup application in your phone. And with that application, you just have to follow our Meetup groups that are already available. So the group names are Emerging Technology Community, Azure Tech Community, Pune for Pune people, Surat and Gujarat Emerging Technology Community for the location Gujarat, Azure Tech Community Nagpur for the Nagpurkers, Artificial Intelligence, AI, Microsoft platform for the people who are particularly interested in AI. You just install an application and follow our groups, please. So this is a small code of conduct for today's session. Please note everyone that you cannot take a screenshot or you cannot do a screen recording. All the recordings will be shared on our YouTube official YouTube channel. So the YouTube channel link will be shared in the chat box. So do follow that. And you will be getting the notification about the recordings once they are uploaded. So today's session is DP100, technology DP100, and the agenda for today's session is create an Azure machine learning workspace and manage compute data and coding environments for machine learning workloads. Use Azure Machine Learning Designer for no-code machine learning model training and deployment. Create and manage data stores and data sets and use them in machine learning experiments. Create and manage compute resources and use them to run machine learning experiments at scale in the cloud. Use pipelines to orchestrate machine learning operations. So that is the agenda. So let me give you an introduction about our today's speaker. So our today's speaker is Mr. Chandrasekhar sir. So Chandrasekhar sir is extensively working since 30 plus years in corporate industry. He had worked with many Fortune companies like Accenture, Infosys, L&T, Intel, then the big names. And yes, along with that, his forte is into big data analytics, machine learning, Azure, Hadoop. These are the technologies where his forte is particularly into. And today's session is being handled by him. So you are going to get so many knowledge. So this is our course calendar for the month. Anyone who's interested to get a training, you can just contact me. The number will be shared in the chat box. Please do follow that. So currently we are offering all the courses at 50% flat off, and into that fee you are going to get live training plus MOC, that is Microsoft official curriculum, along with the exam vouchers. So that's the package that you're going to get with 50% flat off. So the final payable will be 17,500 including taxes. So anyone interested, please let me know on the number which will be shared in the chat box. So this is our CERT Ready webinar series calendar, upcoming webinars. So the next webinar that is going to happen on 3rd July, the topic is DA100, Analyzing Data with Microsoft Power BI. And the other one is on the 24th July, that the topic is PL100, Introduction to Power Virtual Agent. So anyone who is interested in these sessions, kindly register themselves. We'll be sharing the registration link in the chat box again. So currently we are running two different kind of special webinar series. One is CERT Ready and the other is Emerging Technology Trainings. So this is the calendar for emerging technology. People who are interested in the future technologies, they can join us for the sessions. So the next webinar series session is based on DevSecOps with Azure DevOps. And the session is going to happen on 10th of July in the morning, 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. So people who are interested, again, they can register. A special announcement for the event. Firstly, your feedbacks are very important to us. So do not miss to share your valuable feedbacks. And based on those feedbacks that we'll receive, we are going to select 5 lucky winners who are going to get the Microsoft sponsored exam vouchers with which they can attempt any examination for free of cost. So thank you so much. That's it from my end. Now I'll hand over my mic to Chandrasekhar, sir. So you can continue.
Thanks, Rupesh.
Thank you so much.
Will you please go on the mute? Kindly mute yourself, please, so that sir can start the session. So I welcome all of you for this session. A very good afternoon for everybody. Rupesh already has set the agenda for the session, and I will continue with that agenda. So to begin with, exactly, we will try to understand what is a data science. So I am sharing my screen. Would like to know from you whether my audio and whether my screen is reaching to you.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what exactly data science that we will try to understand, but as of now, in brief, what I can say is, data science basically is a process to. Hello. Okay. And whether font size is readable, let me know, please.
Yes, it is readable.
Okay. So data science basically is a process of ingesting data from a variety of the data sources, applying different measures on the data to improve its quality, apply different transformations on the data to make it suitable for, doing the predictions, say, for machine learning, and then using that data to train the machine learning model. Now in data science, machine learning model is a kind of a object, in memory object of a language. If you are using Java language, then it is a Java object. If we are using Python object, then it is a Python object. So machine learning model is a kind of an object which receives the, what we will call as the predictor variables, okay, and do the prediction for you. So for example, if it is a health data for the patient we are submitting to it, so on receipt of that health data, that model is expected to predict the gravity of the agony that patient is going through. So different kinds of predictions and different kinds of analysis that model can do. But behind the curtain, before that model starts doing the prediction, what is necessary is to train the model rigorously on lots of data. So once you train that model on the data, then that model becomes ready to do predictions. And more rigorous the training is, it is a bit obvious that model gives you more accurate results. So this becomes a whole step-by-step pipeline. This is a data science. Where I say everywhere now, as on today, we can see the data science. Whenever you are visiting to YouTube, it starts showing you videos of your liking. It is again a data science only, because somehow, you know, whatever the videos you would have seen in past, accordingly, it has already anticipated your likings, and videos on the similar subject, it starts showing you in the YouTube, or similar is the case in case of Netflix. In case if Netflix realizes that you like adventures movies, then the moment any adventures movie get released on the Netflix, immediately you start getting the messages, or it starts showing you advertises about that movie. So it starts recommending that movie to you. So there again, we call it the recommendation engine. So from everywhere as on today, you can see use of the data science, including Google Map, which is suggesting you a path and the streets to follow to reach to the place in less time by bypassing toll nakas and all those. Okay, so that Google Map is also again an example of data science. Anyway, here I have listed out some of the use cases of data science. So how can enterprise predict demand of the products, okay, so that enterprise can make their inventory ready? So looking at yesterday's data, yesterday's and today's data, that model can predict tomorrow's sell. And when that model predicts tomorrow's sell, enterprise or company gets an idea about how it can keep its inventory ready. Similarly, in medical science also, data science is very much being used. So maybe X-ray charts and different kinds of reports, maybe MRI reports and all those can be analyzed by such type of data science models to do the prediction of any disease that patient is possessing, also to know the gravity of that disease that person is possessing. So in medical science also it is being used, and there are lots of places where it is being used as on today. And I believe everybody knows data science is really hot topic as on today. In data science process, these are different steps to be followed. So we do analysis of the data. Now here you try to understand the difference in between the traditional system and this data science processing. In traditional system, we used to have our data into relational database management system, wherein data is being inserted, only valid data is being inserted, the data which is meeting all the constraints designed there, only that data goes into that system. Okay, so whenever you receive the data from such a system, that data is always reliable, but that is not the case specifically in data science. Here your data may not be completely validated by the system, means you have to have a separate system to ensure the validity of the data. But otherwise, the system that is storing the data may not bother about having only valid data, only data which is meeting all constraints. So here, cleaning of the data, transformation of the data becomes very important step, because whenever you are receiving the data, you have to ensure appropriate benchmark of the quality for that data, okay, before you push or pull that data into analytical processing. So there it needs a data cleansing and data preparation. Okay, and then model feature engineering means, there may be 20 columns data what we are receiving, we now to these columns we may call them as predictor variables. Predictor variables, because these variables are essential for accurate prediction of the result. For example, if bank wants to know whether the loan should be granted for the person looking at his financial status. So financial status will become a kind of input to the prediction system, and that prediction system will predict whether loan can be granted to the customer. So whenever these 20 parameters we are submitting to it, not all 20 parameters may be participating fully in the process of the prediction. There may be some of the parameters which are not very well participating in accurately making the predictions. So that is called as a model feature engineering, wherein we have to identify the parameters which are really critical in making the decision, and less critical parameters can be dropped. So that process is called as a model feature engineering. Here we decide which parameters will mostly affect the accuracy of the prediction. Then we submit these parameters to the model, and thereby we train the model. So we have to submit as much data as we have for the purpose of the training, okay, so that in case if model is properly trained, okay, its accuracy also grows. And sometimes what happens, whenever we are designing this model, it's not a single model we normally design. So there may be multiple algorithms we have to apply. There may be one algorithm with multiple sets of hyperparameters we may have to apply. So there, what happens is we get multiple such models. And every model may have its own, accuracy or even, own level of performance. So we have to choose the best performing model out of that, and then that model we have to deploy on the system. We have to deploy it on the production environment. Okay, and thereafter then, that model starts doing the predictions for end users. So this is basic data science process, and we will be trying to understand this process in further details in our discussion. So business understanding exactly what prediction we want to do, what kind of data do we have, so that is data understanding. So understanding the business problem is the first thing. Understanding what kind of data do we have, understanding what quality upgradations this data attracts. So we have to apply those quality upgradations on that data. So that is called as the data preparation. Okay, so quality upgradation as well as transforming data and making it suitable for the rest of the steps, that is the data preparation. Modeling, it means creating n number of models, maybe by applying different algorithms or maybe by applying different hyperparameters to an algorithm. That is called as a modeling, and choosing the best one. Okay, on that best performance, choosing the best one is a process of evaluation. In the process of evaluation, we have to just test every model on the test data to assess its performance, and the best performing model here we have to choose. And then that model goes into the runtime environment or into the production environment and is deployed there. After some time, you realize that somehow, because of the change in the business, that model starts giving degraded performance. Maybe after 6 months, maybe after 1 year, maybe after 2 years, slowly you start realizing that this model is not giving accuracy, okay, as on today, what accuracy it was giving to us a little long back. So there again, we have to put that model into the same cycle, okay, and then again, we have to train the model, we have to find out a new best performing model. So this cycle continues, okay, and this is a life cycle of the model, okay, wherein after a specific interval of time or after some time, that model has to retrain on the data, and sometimes retrained model, in case if you are retrained model, if it's not giving you enough performance, then you have to again undergo through whole process of finding out the best performing model onto the data which has been incorporated with the new trends in the market. So that's the cycle. You know, after some time, again, that model has to, you know, on that model has to, say, again, we have to apply the steps right from beginning. So that cycle continues in this data science process. Now, in order to do the data science process, we have, I will come back to these slides a little later. Please go on mute. Please go on mute. Yes. In order to perform this process, we have lots of tools available. Okay, if you talk about Java, in Java, tools are available. So, okay. Now here, normally what happens is, in order to do data science process, I already told you, okay, you have to train the model on large data sets. So again, you know, big data comes into its role here in this process. Okay, that big data has can be used. Okay, maybe it can be a historical data or historical data that comes into this process, and that data has to be submitted to the model. That data has to be submitted to a model. So here is a ML model, see. Okay, now we can do this overall process on Hadoop. Whenever, you know, a big data comes into picture, Hadoop has to come into picture. Okay, and then we can use, you know, Mahout or Weka like library here for doing machine learning. Mahout, Weka like library for doing a machine learning processing. Okay, and for this purpose, you know, then you can do the deployment of that model. I again repeat, model is nothing but a language object, in memory object. Okay, so for whenever you are doing this in Java, it will be a Java object running inside Java virtual machine. Java virtual machine. It will be running inside Java virtual machine. Now, how this model, once this object is created, how this model will offer you its services in the production environment. So for that purpose, around this model, you have to have REST service endpoints. Endpoints. So we have to design a REST wrapper around such a model, okay, wherein that REST API will have one type of endpoint which receives predictor variables and which returns prediction as a response. Okay, so receives predictor variables. Now, just to cite an example, gave you the example that bank wants to know the likelihood of a person who can return the loan to the bank if it is granted. In that case, what are all predictor variables? So his annual income can be one of the predictor variables. What are all family responsibilities on him? Has he acquired any other bank loan already? So thereby to calculate his paying capacity of the loan. Those are the predictor variables. And what is a result of it is whether a loan to grant to him or reject for him. Okay, yes or no. So such type of model we have to design. Okay, we can design such type of model in Python also. So in Python, we have scikit-learn like library, scikit-learn like library. Okay, through which we get a different ready ML algorithms, machine learning algorithms are ready available here. as on today, you try to understand, you don't have to write algorithm. These libraries in Java or in Python, there are libraries available which are providing you really thoroughly tested implementation of these algorithms. What you simply have to do is you have to simply choose which all algorithms you want to go with. So normally you prefer to go with multiple algorithms, okay, because you want to create multiple models. So in scikit-learn library of Python, you know, machine learning algorithms are really available. You simply create the object of the algorithm, okay, create object of algorithm. Okay, this is now in-memory object. This is in-memory object. Okay, and this object then you configure with hyperparameters. Now, what hyperparameters are, that we will see little later. Okay, you have to configure it, or we call it as a process of tuning. Tune it in hyperparameters. Now, here also, these libraries are giving you one parameters. Giving one ready kind of approach, that models are set with default hyperparameters. Most likely parameters they are already set with. But default parameters, if are not giving you expected performance, then you can, you know, tune them, and you can choose the different sets of parameters for the model, okay, to know whether it is giving you better performance or not. There is no any thumb rule what type of parameters will give you better performance. Okay, in scenario to scenario basis, you may get different performances. That is one thing. And second thing is, after all, somewhere you have to do a kind of a trial and error. You may have to apply some thumb rules, but you have to apply a kind of a trial and error, okay, by giving different sets of parameters to the model, okay, to check its performance. Okay, so that process is called as a tuning of the model. And once multiple models are created, you have to compare their performances. Compare models for performance and choose the best one. Now, which one is the best one? The model which is giving you highest performance, that is best one. Choose best one. So that is way of creating a model. And whenever you are choosing the best model, then you have to deploy it in the production environment. Now, production environment means ready runtime environment for the model. If it is Python model, then you have to have Python runtime environment. If it is Java model, then you have to have Java runtime environment. Runtime environment for the model. Okay, and what this production environment will do, it will accept data either in terms of a file, okay, for, I mean to say, set of data on which you want to do production. Hello, please go on mute. Anybody has any question, please? Hello. Anybody has any question? Please go ahead. Sorry, voice is breaking. Sorry. Okay. So in the production environment, your model runs within, say, maybe Python environment, and there are endpoints published to the to that model. So these are REST endpoints. REST endpoints can be used to communicate or interact with a model, okay, for predictions or for responses, for prediction responses. Okay, fine. Now here we have seen so on-premise services which are available. There are lots of frameworks available for this. Or say I don't go into that area. Okay, now what are all services available on the Azure? That is very interesting to know. Okay, so I just take you to the slide where we will just quickly do comparison of some of the services which are available there on Azure. So here, these are some products, four products available on Azure, which have a special kind of processing engine, okay, at its heart. So Apache Spark is open source anyway. That is not an Azure product. HD Insight, Azure Databricks, and Synapse Spark. These are three main products. There is a fourth main product also, which I will come to it soon. HD Insight is Hadoop implementation, and we used to get, you know, Spark on that also. So Microsoft implements open source of Spark managed within the realms of the Azure. So Azure, you know, offers complete SLA for the HD Insight product. Besides that, you know, Azure offers interaction with all Azure services through your Python code of the Spark. So Spark you can see inside HD Insight also. Now, in case if some of you are hearing about the Spark for the first time, for them, let me tell you, Spark is a turbo speed, multilingual, analytical processing engine. It does processing in the distributed fashion, and it does its processing mostly in RAM, random access memory. That's why it's the speed of processing is tremendous. Okay, and it is distributed in the sense that it runs at the top of the Hadoop cluster. So it harnesses distributed processing power of the Hadoop. Okay, but keeping some of the drawbacks of Hadoop away. What are all major drawbacks of Hadoop is Hadoop interacts to the storage device very heavily. And as it interacts to the storage device very heavily, its processing speed goes down. So what's the solution Spark offers on this is that Spark does most of its processing in the RAM. And it doesn't go to the disk time and again to bring in the data. Yes, at the beginning, once it brings the data, then it tries to do its processing well within the RAM only. So it is turbo speed processing engine. Similar kind of Spark they are using inside Azure Databricks also. Okay, and they have used this similar kind of engine in Synapse Spark also. Now, HD Insight is executed at the top of Hadoop cluster. Okay, there is a hello. If you have any question, please put forth your question. Otherwise, will you please keep yourself on mute?
Excuse me, I'm so sorry to disturb, but there is a request message that please zoom screen, zoom this PPT itself.
Okay,
so that
okay.
That image will be little more clear.
Okay, thanks.
CP sir, can you please share?
Now let me know, is it readable?
I mean, you can show in presentation mode. That will be more
fine. Okay. Now let me know, is it readable?
It is, yeah. Now, sir.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay. So here you can see for HD Insight. HD Insight is a Hadoop platform. It is an implementation of Hadoop in terms of Hortonworks platform. Okay, and whenever you are provisioning HD Insight cluster, okay, you get a Hadoop cluster at the top of which, okay, you can get multiple services. So one of those services is a Spark service. And you can see a Spark running at the top of the Hadoop, and Spark, you know, harnessing distributed processing power of the Hadoop and thereby, you know, trying to manage big data processing well within the RAM memory only. And that's why, you know, thereby you receive responses very fast. So even if petabyte size of data, if you submit to it, still it will be in position to process it quickly. Okay, so SD Insight is a service available on the Azure. That is also really good service. It offers you SLA, service level agreement it offers you. Okay, and thereby you can do a development of the analytical services specifically by using Spark. Okay, in SD Insight, you know, what are all other benefits you get is, not only you get a Spark, but other types of tools also you can get, like, you know, if you want to use Hive, if you want to use Kafka. So on that SD Insight cluster, single cluster, you can have a multiple services. Okay, and you can create a kind of a collaboration among all these services. Collaboration of all these services, that ecosystem you can design at the top of the SD Insight. In case of Azure Databricks basically is, cluster runtime environment for Spark. It is a runtime environment for Spark. So there you cannot have a Kafka as a part of the Azure Databricks. Kafka can be there as a separate service, but not as a part of the Azure Databricks. So as far as cluster is concerned, in case of SD Insight, it is Hadoop cluster, but in case of Databricks, it is a Databricks cluster. And at the top of that cluster, your Spark runs in the distributed fashion. Okay, it runs in the distributed fashion. So whenever you speak of Spark, anything you want to speak about a Spark, okay, it becomes a turbo speed in-memory processing engine, okay, on which you can do a development using multiple languages. So you can do a development using Java, Python, Scala, R language, SQL. So whatever the background you are from scripting language background, you can use Scala or Python. You are from database background, you can use SQL. If you are from Java background, you can use Java and do a development there. In Azure Databricks, you can ingest the data from variety of the data sources, Azure data sources, like Azure SQL database, Azure SQL data warehouse, Cosmos DB, storage account or data lake store. So from anywhere you can ingest the data, from any kind of Azure service you can ingest the data, or after due processing, you can preserve the data into Azure services. In Azure Databricks, even you can pull the data from non-Azure services also, so that is also possible. In Synapse Spark, they have introduced Synapse Spark basically inside Synapse Analytics to do the processing, analytical processing of Synapse data. So Synapse has serverless pool, Synapse has dedicated SQL pool. Okay, so whatever the data existing in Synapse, that can be processed there inside a Synapse by using Spark engine. So there in Synapse Spark, you don't have to have a separate service. Okay, but all the services of the ecosystem you can have within the Synapse only, and you can ingest the data not only of OLAP workload, but there are arrangements in Synapse Spark even to ingest the data of OLTP workload also. Now OLTP, transactional workload, comes from, you know, data, NoSQL data service like Cosmos DB. Okay, and Synapse can ingest the data from Cosmos DB like service also. So these are different analytical solutions available on the Azure. Okay, the level of automation, the level of, easiness to work with these products, that differ. Okay, what I would like to introduce now about Azure Machine Learning. Azure Machine Learning is a separate service. Now, in this service, you have options to do analytics by writing the code, also to do analytics without writing the code. We call it the no code solutions. So creating the whole data science process we can do here without writing a code or by writing a minimal code. Okay, customized in specific or typical customization only we may have to write the code, but otherwise there are graphical user interfaces through which we can design end-to-end data science pipeline using Azure Machine Learning. So for that purpose in Azure Machine Learning, we have something called as a designer. Now there is nothing like designer in all other services, please note. We have AutoML. So AutoML like service, again, whatever I have mentioned earlier, you know, these services, there is nothing like AutoML in any of these services. Okay, there may be other products available in the market who are offering AutoML. Okay, but otherwise AutoML feature is available here in Azure Machine Learning. So what is designer and what is AutoML? So in brief, I would like to put here that for data science process, we have to write a code either in Java or Python or Scala. But if you are not from any development background and without anybody's help, if you want to create the models, find out their performance and do their deployment, okay, it is possible in Azure Machine Learning. If you are from developer's background, you can achieve as much customization as you want. But if you are not from developer's background, still Azure Machine Learning can offer you, you know, a very quick model creation environment. In Azure Machine Learning, we get compute on which the pipeline that we will be designing using graphics user tools, okay, that we can try, we can run. Okay, I have again repeat, whenever we are design data science pipeline here. Okay, we have to ingest the data from variety of the data sources. So data storage and connectivity. Hello. Okay, we can try our language, say, data pipelines. Okay, we can drag and drop, you know, different steps into that data pipeline, and for every step we can quickly do the say configuration and we can try with it. So we can do the ML workflow orchestration here. Once you have identified best performing model, then just by doing couple of quick clicks, you can register that model into model registration service of Azure. And that model goes into model registration service. Okay, and once that model has been registered, wherever you want that model to be used, maybe in Azure Databricks, you want that model to use, or anywhere else if you want a model to use, you know, that model you can use for the further processing, and further processing is, say, model deployment. Then that model we can deploy in the production environment. Azure Machine Learning also offers you ready production environment. Okay, and there we can do the deployment of the model. So these are the steps very easily we can follow here in say machine learning services. Now, whenever we are creating a machine learning service, I will show you step by step how to create a machine learning service. Okay, whenever you are creating a machine learning service, okay, you create a workspace. Now, what exactly the workspace is? So workspace actually is a storage inside which your different development artifacts are preserved. So whenever you are working in machine learning, okay, you are creating models, you are creating experiments, you are creating pipelines, you are creating notebooks, you are creating your compute. So all these things we will see step by step what they are. Okay, but in order to hold all these things, all these business assets, okay, workspace is created for me, and inside this workspace, all these business assets are maintained. So here you can see the list of the business assets. Whenever machine learning workspace is created, these are different components created. All these are the supportive components for machine learning workspace. So machine learning workspace creates these components. So, and one of the major components is the storage account. So somehow down the line, it creates a storage account. And on that storage account, all business artifacts are preserved. So in the resource group, we will create a machine learning workspace, and inside the workspace, then we can create these business assets. So I do one thing now. I create a machine learning workspace for you. So let me take you to the portal. Anybody has any question? Please go ahead. Okay, I got one question. Just a minute. Processing of data for the first time is done by Hadoop, then it will be taken from RAM through the Spark. Can you please explain this? Okay. So I think your question is about HD Insight. So let me just quickly draw one diagram. Whenever we are speaking about Hadoop, okay, in Hadoop, we have two types of major components there. So let me draw those components here. So here is HDFS, and here is yarn or processing structure. So this is HDFS, and this is compute, say distributed compute of Hadoop. I'll do one thing, just a minute. Okay. No, I do one thing, just a minute. I take a smaller rectangle here. This is a compute, distributed compute of Hadoop. Now, if you are from Hadoop background, let me just mention the services, Hadoop services, like MR, MapReduce, Yarn, Resource Manager, Resource Scheduler, and etc. Okay, so what Hadoop does is Hadoop provides distributed compute, and Spark runs here. So here is a Spark. Now, what part of Hadoop Spark uses? Let us see. Spark. So Spark does not use MapReduce of Hadoop. What else Spark uses is HDFS, Yarn, Resource Manager, all these things Spark uses. But Spark does not use MapReduce. Like MapReduce, Spark has its own API. Spark has its own API in the Python language. We call it the PySpark. So this is an alternative to MapReduce. What is the difference in between MapReduce and PySpark? That this PySpark is capable of doing in-memory processing. MapReduce does processing mostly by interacting with a storage device. Okay, PySpark uses in-memory processing. So yes, data first of all comes into HDFS, and from there, you know, that is picked up by this PySpark. And thereafter, once data goes into memory, okay, where that data goes into memory, I'm just using some of the terminologies for some of you who are aware of these terminologies. In case if you are not aware of the terminologies, just ignore them. Okay, so that data goes into something called as a RDD, Resilient Distributed Data Set. Resilient Distributed Data Set represents this big data in memory. It represents it in memory. So data goes into the RDD, and thereafter. Okay, from one RDD it may create another RDD, from another RDD it will create a next RDD. So end-to-end processing of the pipeline happens in the RAM, and for that purpose it may have to create multiple RDDs. Okay, RDD is a big data representation in the RAM. Okay, that you can in the simple words you can count it. Big data representation in the RAM, that is RDD. And yes, once data reaches to the HDFS, it will pick up it, will arrange it into RDD in RAM, it will complete the processing of those RDDs, and finally then, you know, yeah, that data may go back to the HDFS. So that's how processing happens whenever Spark is running at the top of Hadoop cluster. Have I made this point clear? Let me know whether it is clear or not, or otherwise I will try to, you know, re-explain it in the other words. Mr. Nagendra? Huh, okay.
Yeah, I got it. Thanks.
So I was taking you to design, develop the service, create the service. Okay, so here is my Azure portal. On this Azure portal, here I have created machine learning service. Let me show you how I can create the service. Okay, under the analytics, under AI plus machine learning, I believe everybody here is aware of the portal, so I just don't explain you portal. Okay, here is the machine learning, which comes under AI plus machine learning here. So when I click on create, there it will ask me the details about in which resource group I want to create it, what is the workspace name, in which region, the storage account. I may use already existing storage account, or I can create a new storage account. In case if I already have business assets developed in past, and those business assets are preserved on the storage account, I want to use same set of business assets today, okay, with this new instance of this machine learning service, I can do that by choosing already existing storage account, or otherwise I can create a new storage account also. Do I want to use already existing key vault, application insight, or container registry? Those options I can choose from here. Okay, and when I click on review plus create, you know, this service is created. Okay, whenever this service is created, now it will take 10-15 minutes for creation of that service. So what I did is, I already have kept a service ready for you. So here it is. Whenever it makes the service ready, after due provisioning of the service, it gives you a dialogue with a button, which when you click, it will take you to this overview page of that service. So this is the overview page of the service. And on this page, okay, here you will see Launch Studio. Launch Studio. So whenever you are clicking on Launch Studio, it opens a new tab, and in that a new tab, it opens a new portal. Okay, and here is the portal. Okay, if you want to see it again, I will click on Launch Studio. Okay, and it will take me to a new tab wherein it will open everything in the new portal. Here it is. Now here you will see notebooks, automated ML, and designer. Designer means, I already told you, this is no code approach. Automated ML also, it is no code approach. You don't have to write a code. Although it doesn't mean that they are not offering you any customization, there is a customization, limited customization they are offering, but otherwise mostly it is no code approach. So designer basically, whenever I choose for the designer, okay, this kind of pipeline I can design. Okay, here are different activities available, and here you can see machine learning algorithms. Lots of machine learning algorithms are available here. So there are regression algorithms. Here you can see decision forest regression, linear regression. So multiple regression algorithms are available there. Poisson regression. So you don't have to write any code to define the algorithm. They are giving you ready code written there. And you simply have to drag and drop that algorithm on this canvas. This is called as a canvas. Here you simply have to drag it and drop it. Okay, so multiple such algorithms are available, but before you apply the algorithms, you have to, you know, force that data to undergo lots of transformations. So there are different transformations options available. So all common type of transformation approaches are available here. So adding new column, adding new rows, applying different mathematical operations there. So for example, if you want to, you know, if you want to improve the quality of the data by doing some kind of normalization, so all those options are available here. If you want to clean the data by applying different cleaning mechanisms, that is also possible. So different cleaning, transformation, metadata changing, here is the edit metadata, we'll be using some of them. Joining, so one data set to join with another data set. Normalization, whenever we want all the numeric columns to be brought into same scale, there we do normalization. Lots of such options are really available for you, availing them without writing the code. Split data, lots of operations are available. Okay, from where you will bring the data? So you can bring the data from the data sets. Now, data set basically represents your data source. It represents your data source. So how to create a data set, that also we will see. Okay, and from that data source, we will incur the data. We will apply transformations on the data. Then we will apply, say, machine learning algorithms on that. Okay, and then after we apply machine learning algorithm, there are the model training, there are model scoring, like options are available. As far as transformation is concerned, in case if you want to do a kind of a customization, that is possible in R language and Python language. So R language code, Python language code can be written, and you can add a customization in transformation there. Text analysis can also be done. Computer visioning can also be done. So deep learning models can also be made possible here. So lots of operations are available here. Okay, let me just check whether I have got any message. So I haven't got yet. Okay, fine. In case if you have any question, please unmute yourself, and at any moment you can raise the question. Okay, so by using designer, it's almost a no code approach. Okay, you can design your data pipeline, and in the second part of our today's discussion, I will design a data pipeline for you. Okay, automated ML. Again, automated ML is a, you know, graphics user interface. Okay, there again, you simply have to, you know, man, let's say, give some information, and rest of the things it takes care. So what is the difference in automated ML and designer? In automated ML, you know, you simply have to submit the data to it, and what type of algorithm you want to apply there, that simply you have to give. Is it a regression algorithm, or is it a classification algorithm, or is it a recommendation, or any kind of algorithm? That simply you have to submit. It chooses different and different algorithms, applies different and different hyperparameter data sets over there, creates n number of models for you, and it shows you metrics. Which model is best performing in what sense? It shows you metrics, so it does you comparison also. And then, if you want to go with the best performing model, you can immediately deploy it. So automated ML gives you really automated approach wherein you don't have to even design pipeline how you design in the designer. Okay, but more is the automation, less is your intervention, then you have to, you know, bother say whatever it offers to you. Little chance of customization. So automation is good, but it limits your intervention. It limits your scene. So, and in notebook. In notebook, it gives you Jupyter notebook. And in Jupyter notebook, okay, it gives you a way to write a Scala, SQL, or Python code. That code you can write there. Okay, and you can design whole data pipeline, data science pipeline, programmatically by using notebook. So notebook needs thorough knowledge of the language, but offers you ultimate level of customization. Fine, what are all other things? Let me quickly introduce you to them, and then we will take a quick 5 minutes break. Okay, and post break, then we will start creating a simple data pipeline. Dataset represents your data source, exactly which file you want to refer to. Okay, what are all different columns in that file? Hello, anybody has any question? Hello? Portal of creation chargeable or not? If pay for service, then developer how much charges? I believe your question is that whenever we are creating a service, whether it is chargeable or not. Yes, it is chargeable, but it is not utilizing. At this point of time, it doesn't use a costly compute. So charges are minimal. Okay, so I created that service. Okay, so having that service there, it is not charging much to me. So real charges starts applying when I create the compute and when I start the compute. Okay, so I will show you when your charges, when it start charging you in the bill. It doesn't mean that this service without a compute is free of cost. It doesn't mean it charges very little. Because, you know, down internally it has created a storage account. So charge of the storage account anyway becomes applicable to your ML service. Okay, real charges, it starts incurring in my bill. Okay, when I start the compute. So what are all different computes, that also I will explain to you. So here, anybody has any other questions? Suggest whether where Databricks come into picture with respect to the diagram you created in MS Paint and Azure ML service. Databricks. Okay. Now here, for this Spark, I have multiple options. No? One of the options is HD Insight. Another option is Databricks. Third option is Synapse Spark. Multiple options are available here. And for all these options, you know, somewhere, you know, it has to run this Spark on the cluster. So in case of HD Insight, it is Hadoop cluster. In case of Databricks, it is a Databricks cluster. In case of Synapse, it is compute cluster of the Synapse. So clusters are different. Okay, those clusters may be using distributed compute of Hadoop, or those clusters may have their own policy of dealing with the distributed processing. But the clusters are, you know, vendor specific, but at the top of that cluster, you know, Spark runs. That Spark may come from Databricks, or it may come from HD Insight, or it may come from Synapse Spark. And alternative to all of them for machine language, so processing, machine learning, not machine language, sorry, machine learning. Alternative to all of them is a Azure product ML service. So ML service offers you alternative to all of this. Why you will prefer going with ML service? Because it has a designer, it has auto ML, and it has a notebook also through which ultimate level of customization you can achieve. So designer and auto ML definitely offer you upper hand over HD Insight, Databricks, and Synapse Spark. It offers upper hand. I made this point clear. Let me know. Yes, go ahead.
It's not a question, basically. Actually, if you have a time, could you just summarize whatever the point we have discussed? Because I'm joined a bit late, actually. So, if you have a time, it's fine.
We will see whether time allows us to explain it. But as of now, I have to take care of all of us. So just hold your breath. We will see whether we can do that discussion separately.
Yeah, okay. Sure.
Yeah. Is the data preparation is also part of model creation? No, actually. It is a part of data science. What was the life cycle? Data preparation is one of the stage in data science life cycle, and model creation is another step in data science life cycle. But model creation means just identifying best performing model without by assuming that our data has already been clean and proper. Okay. Coming back here, so I was explaining about the data set. Data set represents the data source. Okay, now whenever data set has to represent a data source, you need a credential to connect to the data source also. Those credentials go into data store. So data store represents the set of the credentials to connect to actual data source. Okay, and what data set represents? Data set represents actual data from that data source. So data store represents credentials to connect to the data source, and data set represents actual data of that data source. Fine. Experiment. What do you mean by experiment? So experiment, first of all, let me explain you pipelines. So whatever I have shown to you in the designer, okay, I already have shown to you in the designer. This is called as a designer pipeline. So what is a pipeline basically? Pipeline basically is a set of steps to be carried out and the order in which we want to carry out those steps. So that is the pipeline. So pipeline includes steps like ingesting the data, applying the different cleansing, munging, and transformation steps here. So here we are cleaning the data and then applying model training. So here we are applying the model training, model scoring, okay, and then finally evaluation of the model. So all these steps are arranged in appropriate order. So it is a pipeline. Now this pipeline, I have to run time and again. So every execution of this pipeline, is maintained under the head experiments. The experiments give me a collection of the different runs of the pipeline. And once after repeated execution of the pipeline, I realize that I have identified a best performing model. That model then we register with a model registration service. This is model registration service. And finally, then registered model we deploy on the production environment. And there we create endpoints. Okay, so now whenever I am running my pipeline for the purpose of the testing, I have to run it on the different types of compute. Okay, so I will explain to you about the computes also. Okay, but I think it is a time for 3-4 minutes break. Okay, 2-3 minutes break. So by what time will you be able to come back and resume the session? So will it be possible for you to come back in 3 minutes, 3 to 5 minutes?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, we can join at 3:20.
Yeah.
Okay. So we will resume session by 3:20. In the meantime, I have got a couple of questions. Okay, how Azure handle high frequency data ingestion in the pipeline processing, or say real time data? Okay, that is one question. Can we define MLOps implementation pipeline using Azure ML component? Yes, that is also possible. Okay, MLOps also is possible. That that is to be achieved through MLOps. Okay, by end of the session, I will put a couple of words on that. Okay, so let us have a small break then, and we will resume the session by 3:20. How Azure handle high frequency data ingestion? Maybe by end of the session, I will talk on that also. Huh? Yes. So fine, then I will go on the mute for a while. And I will unshare the screen.
After the session, will you share the recording also with us?
Yes, the recordings will be shared on our YouTube channel. So the link is already been shared in the chat box. So you can refer that and you can follow the channel. And once the recording will be updated, you will get a notification.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Can you please share the YouTube channel link again? I am not able to locate in the chat box.
Yeah, I'll share it once again. Just a moment.
Thank you.
Hope all are back. Okay, I have got a couple of questions here. Data transformation or data cleaning process. Okay, when there are columns which are not contributing to improve the accuracy of the model, I guess we calculate the mean, median and mode to populate the missing data to improve the model accuracy. Do we have that in the Azure ML? Yes, yes, we do have that, and I will show to you. Whether my screen is reaching to you?
Yes. Yes, the screen is visible, sir.
Okay. So fine, then what we will do, I will just quickly show you how to use this designer. Okay, but before that, in case if you go to the compute, there you will see four options of compute. Compute instance basically is for writing the notebooks and testing or running the notebooks. So whenever you create a compute instance, whatever commands you write in Jupyter notebook, those commands are executed on compute instance. So compute instance basically is for Jupyter notebook. Okay, there we have Monaco notebook and a Jupyter notebook. Both options are available. Any one type of notebook you can choose for the purpose of the development. Okay, compute cluster, this is for designer and automated ML. Here, whatever instance you create, that is, on that instance, your designer pipeline gets executed. So in case if I am planning to create one simple designer pipeline, okay, for that I have to create a compute cluster. Okay, inference cluster basically is for production environment. So in case of inference cluster, then I will get two options like container instances or Kubernetes, AKS. Okay, so one of those two options I have to choose. Okay, and I can see my deployment is happening here on inference cluster. Okay, and then attached compute basically is to offer to it, okay, to offer to your notebook, okay, compute other than compute instances. So there may be compute of the Databricks. There may be compute you have created on virtual machine. On that compute instances, if you want to run your Python code, then there are attached computes. So attached computes are the other types of computes available in Azure services. I will have to create a compute cluster here. So I am creating one compute cluster, clicking on new. And here I have to submit some information. I just want it to be created in HTOS 2. I can choose any location from here. Even locations in Southeast Asia are also available, which are near to us. Okay, let me just check, have I received any message? No. Okay. Virtual machine priorities, dedicated or low priority. I want to go with a dedicated because I want to run it right away. So dedicated virtual machine type. I just do not want to go with a GPU. GPU comes with graphics drivers and hardware suitable for graphical processing. Okay, I will go with a CPU. I will choose with the recommended options. Otherwise, in case if you want the machines with a higher configuration, that is also possible. So I am going with the recommended option here, and then I can click on the next. Okay, so here what it will do, it will ask me the size of the cluster, okay, and it will start creating the cluster for us. Okay, so I may be giving a name as Chandra Compute, some compute name I'm giving. Okay, auto scaling is possible. I just make the size of this cluster fix with two nodes and maximum number of nodes also two. Okay, so I am creating a cluster of size two. Okay, and in case if it takes a long time for me to interact with that cluster, it will start, you know, shutting down the cluster. So for how much timeout should I declare? That is what it is asking. I am going with whatever the default. And then I have to click on the create, and then it will start provisioning the cluster. So I am clicking here on the create, and now it is going to take next 5 minutes for provisioning the cluster. In the meantime, we will start doing the designer pipeline. Okay, so now let it take next couple of minutes for creating the cluster. So I go to the designer now. Okay, before I go to the designer, I have to pull the data and I have to create a data source. So I am clicking on data store here. I already have told you data store basically to hold the credential information or the information needed to connect to the data source. I have one file created, uploaded into storage. So here is that file. I have uploaded it in some storage. So this is my storage storage service. This is blob storage, and I have uploaded one file there. Now this file has, you know, data which needs a cleansing, which needs a transformation. So, okay, now let us see how, you know, first of all, connect to this storage from ML service. Okay. Compute is ready, what it is saying. Okay, that's great. It has been made ready very quick. I don't think it has been made ready. It is resizing. Still, it is resizing. Two nodes are yet to create. Okay, fine. Its submission is successful. The compute is not yet ready. I have to create a data store. So I am clicking on new data store. Here it is asking me loan data. So I may be mentioning loan data store, loan data, store loan data. Data type, blob storage, subscription details, storage account. So storage account, I am choosing this one. Okay, and container. I think it is in Azure ML. Let me just check where I have kept it. Shared material, sorry, not Azure ML. It is in shared material. Here it is. Okay, and yes, save the credentials, account key I can submit. Okay, so I have to go to that storage and I have to bring the account key from there. So here I go. And I bring account key. So access key. Key one or key two, any one access key I can select. So I have copied access key and that access key I submit here. And yes, configuration and all necessary credentials to connect to the data store from ML service has been given. I'm clicking on create and store loan data, like data store it has created. So data store represents the credential to connect to the data source. Now on that data source, which file has the data which I want to utilize in using in designing. So for that purpose, I am going to data sets and here I will create a new data set. Okay, so here I will create a new data set. Okay, new data set will allow me to choose which file, what data we want this data set to represent. Okay, so from data store, data set name, maybe loan. Loan data. Now the file from where I am pulling the data, that is a CSV file. And in CSV file, the first row, the very first row, is representing schema of that file. So it is CSV text file, ordinary text file, which I can, you know, try opening in Excel sheet also. Okay, so it is a tabular form, file, because that file has schema. What is other option available here? It is a file. So in case if it is image, which doesn't have a schema, I would have chosen for file, but as of now I am choosing for tabular. Okay, then I am clicking on next. Excuse me, will you please go on the mute? Store loan data. So data store I am choosing from here. Okay, and here then it is asking me to browse to the file. So from here I am browsing to loan data raw.csv. This is the file already uploaded onto that on that storage. Okay, and I just do not want it to skip the data validation. I want it to go with a validation. So that box I'm not checking. Clicking on the next. Okay, so what it has done is it has identified the format of the data, format of the data in that CSV file. It is a file delimited by comma. Its encoding is UTF-8. Okay, column header, all files have same header. I don't want to skip any row. Okay, and here it is populating that data. So it is showing me that it has successfully connected to the storage and it has successfully created the data set. So here is the data, gender. This data represents the bank customers. So gender of the customer, marital status of the customer, how many dependents are there, education, self-employment, whether he is self-employed or not, what is his annual income, what is annual income of the co-applicant, okay, how much loan he is requesting for how much term he is requesting the loan, okay, any credit history, okay, this is now for real estate, home loan say, okay, in which area of the city, okay, he wants to purchase the house and have a home loan, okay, and loan status, okay, loan status means this is the customer data, this is historical data of the customer. So for these customers, okay, have they returned the loan back to the bank? So that is also being shown. So loan status, zero means that customer was defaulter, and one means that customer was successfully returned the loan. So what kind of prediction we can do using this data? So in case if today one customer comes to the bank, okay, bank will gather the information about him, like marital status, dependents, education, self-employment, applicants income, co-applicants income. Okay, and we want a model to predict, depending on the data what that customer has submitted, okay, how much is the likelihood of that customer to return the loan. So whether likelihood is less than 50%, it is zero. It means unlikely he will return the loan. And if likelihood is more than 50%, it means one, yes, most likely he will return the loan. So that's the way this ML model will do a prediction. Okay, with this, then I'm clicking on the next. Here are all columns. I want to select all the columns. In case if I want to drop some column, that I can do by unchecking this, by not including that column. Okay, what it has also done is it has gone through initial 100-200 records to know the type of that column. So it has gone through this column and has realized that in first 200 records, you know, all values are integer. So it has anticipated the type of that column as integer. So it has inferred the schema here. So it has inferred the schema also. Clicking on next. Okay, and yes, this is a fine. We want to go with it and clicking on create. And it will create the data set. So here it has created a loan data set. Okay, so now my data set is also ready. Data store I have created, loan data set I have created. And I already have, you know, submitted creation of the compute. So let me just check in the meantime. Compute is ready. Yes, it is ready. Okay, so your compute is ready. Two nodes are ready. Okay, and now what I do, I go to designer and I create a new blank pipeline. So I am clicking on designer. I am clicking on new pipeline. Okay, now pipeline means what I already have told you, that it is a set of the steps to be executed in a specific order. Now this pipeline, I want to test and I want to try running it time and again. So I have to choose on which compute I will run that pipeline. So I already have given one compute for creation. It's a Chandra compute that I am giving to it. Okay, so compute I am associating with his pipeline, and that created Chandra compute I have associated with the pipeline. And now here I am ready to start creating the pipeline, say. So the first, very first thing is I want to bring the data from the data set. So set loan data that I am dragging here. This is a loan data set we just have created. Okay, if I want to see the output and when I am dragging it, what data does it have? If I want to check, I can click on the output. Okay, and I can visualize the output of that file. Okay, and here I can see that data. See, these are the columns. These are the columns. And one more thing you observe here. Okay, it is going, giving me spread of the data and distinct value of the data. So it is also giving me spread of the data. And here you observe applicants income and co-applicants income. This is giving me what we will say, right skewed histogram. It is giving me right skewed histogram. So this right skewed histogram is suggesting to me that the data that we have collected has low income data mostly. Low income data mostly. It does mean that this data is not good enough for doing the prediction for high income strata. Okay, so this data is not good enough for doing prediction for high income strata. I want, means in case if you are from data analysis background, you know that the curve or histogram should always be of the bell type. Okay, I may want to convert this data into bell type. And for that purpose, there are, you know, couple of steps I may apply here to convert it to the bell type. So loan amount, yes, it is bell type, bell shaped. If I click on applicant's income, here it is showing me central tendency of that data. So here is the mean, here is the median. Okay, so it is showing me central tendency of the data. Co-applicant's income, here also I can see a central tendency of the data. So normally in coding, you have to write Python steps to see such a central tendency. Here I am getting those things ready. Okay, so here what I am thinking is applicants income and co-applicants income need a kind of transformation or cleansing. We have to improve its quality, and for that purpose then I want to improve the quality. So first measure what I will do is I will sum the applicants and co-applicants income first. I will sum them up. Okay, and then I will check whether the addition of these two columns give me a good kind of quality. So in order to sum them up, okay, somebody also put the question to me say what are all different cleaning. Hello, will you please go on the mute? What are all different cleaning steps you can apply? So under a data transformation, lots of cleaning steps are available. So I will just bring a couple of steps to your notice. Apply math operation. So I may have to apply kind of a math operation. So applicant's income and co-applicant's income, I want to sum up. Okay, so that operation I simply dragged here. Math operation I want to apply. I am just closing it for a while. I will come back to this configuration later. I just link them. So this is the way I am linking them. And after I link them, now the data that is coming from the data set will reach to this apply math operation. And what kind of math operation I apply there, I sum up two columns. I add two columns, so operations. Now here you can see, if you go to basic, you know, lots of single column operations you can get. These are all single column operations. So logarithm you can apply, factorial you can apply, exponent you can apply, all these are single column operations. If you want to apply multi-column operations, then you have to go to operations, and here then multi-column or two-column operations I can do, add, divide, multiply, subtract. Out of these, I go with add, and I just want two columns to add, so both the arguments of the add operation are column set, not constant. I just do not want any to add any constant number there. I just want two columns to add. So second argument, co-applicant's income, I may click here, and here it is showing me the list of. So co-applicant's income is the second column. I want to have it here, clicking on save. The first column is the applicant's income that I can choose from here. Here is the hyperlink edit column. There I am choosing applicant's income. Save. Okay. And after adding, I want this new column to be appended. I just do not want it to override any existing column. So append. Put mode, I am submitting. Append is output mode. Okay, after I have submitted this, now I close it. Okay, and I just run these two steps. Okay, I can add one more step here, but I just want to show what kind of next step it needs after I see the result of this second step. So here I am clicking on the submit, and it is asking me to create a new experiment. So experiment is basically an object which holds telemetry of every execution. Okay, so Chandra EXPR, some experiment name I am giving, pipeline name, clicking on submit. So experiment it will create, and then to that experiment I will submit. I think my cluster has gone down. Let us wait. It will have to uplift the cluster. Okay, in the meantime, what I explained to you, I explain a similar kind of pipeline I already have created. Okay, so I take you to the another pipeline which I already have created. So I just open it in the another tab. Okay, so here you can see I am procuring data from loan data set, and this is apply math operation. Let me just check, have I received any question? No. How can we split data in 30-70? Okay, I will explain that. Please mute yourself, getting noise. Can everyone please act? Sorry. Okay. Okay, fine. Okay. And here I am applying the operation, doing the addition of two columns. And here you can see one column I have already chosen as a co-applicants column. Another column is applicants income and then append. Okay, so in this case, what happens is after I put it to run, here I get one additional column, which is the sum of applicants and co-applicants income. So here I get additional column, which is the sum of applicants and co-applicants income. Now there again, I will see that central tendency and I will see that histogram, whether now at least little, whether that histogram is tilted towards the right side and whether it's the right skewed is reduced or not. If still it is not reduced, then I may apply another measure. So here I am applying another measure and I am applying another mathematical operation. Okay, and what I am doing is I am calculating log 10 of the added column. Here is the added column. Log 10 of added column. What log 10 does is it changes the scale of the data. Okay, and there may be $4,000 and $8,000. Okay, it changes that scale into a size of 0 to 0.1. It changes that scale, not into 0.1, sorry, in 0 to 9.9999. It changes the scale, and when it changes the scale, feature of the data is not changed, only scale is changed. And when I change the scale, I realize it's I realize that histogram is now a bell shape. So by applying addition of two columns, when I realized it did not work, then I applying logarithmic there, and I then converted it into bell shape. Many such measures are available there. Okay, whenever values are missing, I got a question that whenever values are missing, can we replace them with a mean, mode, median? Yes, that is also possible. So that also I will show to you. Okay. In the meantime, I think my compute is ready. Let me just check with the compute. Is it ready or not? Yes, it is ready. Now I can run that pipeline, that two-step pipeline. Let me run. Asking me to set the compute again. Yes. And this two-step pipeline I am submitting to the experiment and clicking on submit. And step one and step two, it will execute. Okay, I can see the result of the step one, how it has added the two columns. That also I can see. Okay, and my steps are executed. I will show you the output of the step two. Okay, and in this output, you will see it has created, appended, not created, created and appended one last column. Here it is. 6091 is a value which is nothing but a sum of 4583 and 1508. So for every row, these two column values it has added and created a new column. Okay, but again, if you observe the histogram, okay, is still right skewed. So then I can think of applying log value there. So for that purpose, again, I drag mathematical operation here. I link them. And on which column I want to apply what operation? So I want to apply log 10 here. So category basic, I already told you basic is for column level operations. And then here I choose for log 10. Column set. So which column I want that logarithm to be applied. So there I drag and the last column I am selecting, clicking on save. And yes, it is done. Okay. Now let us see after I apply log. okay, whether it has changed the quality, so that I am submitting now again for the run. When I submit it for the run, okay, all earlier steps which it has already executed, though the steps are simply validated, those are not re-executed. So the step one and step two, it will simply validate. So you will see directly it will jump its execution to step three. It is in the process of validating it, and now it has started executing the step three. And in step three, we will see the distribution of the normalized data there. Okay, and we will see that its quality has been little improved. So such a data then we can, you know, use for the purpose of the cleaning. In the meantime, hello, yes.
Yeah, I Chandra, I had a doubt. Like, for example, we have local file and we need to use them in data stores and use that data set. How is it done?
You can create your own storage account. In that storage account, you can upload that file. I don't know the format of the file. In case if it is CSV, JSON like file, you can upload it on the storage. And I also did the same thing. I uploaded it in the storage, and then I shown you how can we create a data store to connect to the storage, and how can we create a data set to represent the data of that file.
Okay. So basically we have to take it from storage account, then we can use it over.
Yes. Means, you know, there are many such operations, options available from where you want to take it. There can be data lake store also. Okay, but somehow you have to manually first of all upload it, okay, and then upload it to some of the service of the Azure, and then you can get it here in ML service.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay, let us see the output of this last step. So here it is, and let us see what new column it has added. So it has added Lockton, okay, and now here you can see the histogram is almost bell-shaped. It is not one side skewed now. So quality of this particular data column has been improved. Okay, what next thing I do is that column name, if you see, it has become very long column name. Okay, I want to make it short. So here you can see very long column name. I want to make it short. For that purpose, I just add a metadata here. Okay, so metadata. Edit metadata. So that I am dragging and dropping here. Metadata will, you know, rename the column of the schema. Lots of, you know, schema related operations I can do. I can rename the column, I can change the column type. Okay, so here, which column I want to rename? So the last one, save. Data type, I don't want to change. Categorical, no. Fields, no. Column names, so total income. So I want to change its name to total income. And yes, that is done. So that column name has been changed. Now, I just do not put it to run again. I just add 2-3 steps and then I will put it to run again. I just want to clean the data. So clean missing data. Now somebody asked me the question, okay, how can we, replace the missing data with mean, mode and median? Okay, so I have multiple options available here. Columns to be cleaned. So I may be choosing for all the columns. Okay, so I may be choosing for all the columns. So all columns I want to just clean for the purpose. Or otherwise I can choose a single column. Okay, and from here I may apply cleaning mode. So here you will see on that single column, if you want to do the replacement with a mean value, mode value or median value, that is also possible. What straightforward I am doing is I am choosing for remove entire row. Okay, but if I want to apply mean or median, I can choose those columns on which I want to apply mean or median for replacing the missing values, I can do that. Fine. Remove entire row. It means in case if it gets some value which is missing, I just do not want that record there in the process. Okay. So you observe here what are all other options available. Okay. And lots of such options are available there, which we can use for the purpose of the cleaning. Yes. So this is I am clean missing data, all operations, sorry, all columns, and yes, remove entire row. Then I want to do splitting. So somebody asked me the question regarding how can we do a skill cleaning. Okay, so from here we can do a cleaning using how can we do the replacement of mean and median values. So that I have shown to you. Somebody asked me the question, how can we do splitting of the data? Okay, so here what I do now, I want to split the data, and I want to, in case if there are 1000 rows, I want 700 rows to be taken separately and 300 rows to be taken separately. I want two parts of that data to be created, because 700 rows I may be using for the purpose of the testing, and 300 rows we will use for the purpose. So, sorry, 700 rows we will use for the purpose of the training, and 300 rows we will use for the purpose of the testing. Okay, so for that purpose, what I can do, I will have to search here for splitting. Split the data that I can drag and drop here. Huh. And what is the percentage of splitting? So here, the fraction of the rows in the first output data set. Now, first output data set means the data which will come into the left end point. Here you will see this is one activity which takes a single input point, end point, but there are two output end points. The left end point represents mostly a training data, and right end point represents testing data. So there is no training or testing data, but in the left end point, I want 70% of data. So I mention here, 7. In the left side, the first output data set from the left, I want 70% of data. And what it will do to the right side, it will automatically bring 300 records. Okay, so that's the way I can, you know, split the data or declare the percentages. Okay, to the left side, I will get 700 records. To the right side, I will get 300 records. 700 records we will use for the purpose of the training, okay, and 300 records we will later use for the purpose of the what we will call it as the testing. Okay, so I am ready with my training data. Now this training data I want to submit to the step which will train the model. Okay, but the step that trains the model, okay, needs two things. Train the model. It needs two things. Train the model. One is the training data. So that training data I am submitting from here. And another is which model, which algorithm to apply. So I have to select the algorithm. Okay, and that algorithm will be a first input to the trained model. So maybe I am applying linear regression. I am applying linear regression. So here is a linear regression. So linear regression is an algorithm. Split data has a training data here. Both those things I am submitting to the trained data. And here actual training will be done. Okay. Okay, finally, scoring. It means so test data to be submitted to the trained model. So that is the process that is called as the scoring. Okay, score. Score model. fine. To the score model, now score calculates the performance of the model. Huh? So there are two inputs to the score model. One is it needs a trained model as one input, and another is a test as another input. Okay, so there were questions regarding how can we divide a split the data. So that also I have shown. Okay, and here I have shown you. I got some question perhaps. Can we run two models in parallel, like one algorithm on one branch and another algorithm on another branch? Yes, it is possible. That is possible. Okay, let me add one more activity here. Evaluate model. Evaluate model means whenever I want two models to compare. Okay, so this is one pipeline for one model, which I will connect to this. Okay, I can design another pipeline here, maybe by applying another algorithm, and that I can connect to this. And this evaluate model then will show me the comparison between these two models. It will show me a comparison between these two models. So it is possible to design two pipelines here. Okay, these pipelines are concurrently executed, and both the models are submitted here. Their telemetry is submitted here to evaluate model, and this evaluate model will show me a kind of comparison. Before I move ahead, let me check with Manish, because it is almost 4 o'clock, and Manish, are you there? Rupesh, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Is it possible for me to stretch the session little bit?
Yes, you can, sir. You can.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so that is possible. Okay, but I just don't show you here. It is because, it will take little more time for me. Okay, and you will say that I haven't completed it well within time. Okay, so just I'm keeping it aside, but it is possible. Okay, let me just put this much thing to submit, and I am submitting it. Oh, I have forgotten one more the parametric value to mention here. So in train model, I have to submit the label column, the target column. Target column basically is to show the label, loan status. So that I have to submit here, loan status. So loan status means whether loan to be granted or not to be granted. So edit column, and here loan status is the column that I will have to submit here as a label, because that is a prediction what I am expecting it to do. Yes, that one parametric value I forgot to mention here. And now there is a red mark. I can submit it. Experiment, submit. These are the steps. Now it will quickly run. Okay, so these two steps it has already executed. The remaining steps now it will quickly run. Okay, and it will show me that model is ready. I can check the performance of the model. Okay, and then we can think of doing the deployment of the model. In the meantime, if you have any further questions, please put them. Sir, we have to use logistic model as we have target column binary values. So yes, I agree with you. Instead of linear regression, I would have selected logistic regression or decision forest classification. I would have selected that also. But here I do expect some output. So I will not get a result at 0 or 1. Okay, I may get a result at 0.30 or 0.90. So 0.90 is towards 1. So I will assume it as a 1. 0.00 is towards 0. I will assume it as a 0. Okay. Somebody asked me how to work with a dynamic data. So in case if data is coming as a stream, now how can we deal with it? So yes, that is also not a big deal. Here I have created the data set. This data set basically is linked to a file in the storage. Now, if in that storage, newer and newer data is getting appended, that appended data becomes a part of this data set. And recently appended data, you know, here we can see in the data set. So this data set not only represents a static data, it also can represent dynamic data. So that is also possible. Okay. Where do we change the matrix, like accuracy or ROC? I will show you. Telemetry, if you want to have a look at, that is possible. Okay, now it is in the process of splitting the data. Now it is in the process of training the model.
Sir, what should be the timing, let's say, for if dealing with the 10 million records?
No, come again, please.
No, I'm thinking, like, let's say, how much, I mean, what is the performance of doing that? Like, let's say we're handling of 10 million records, 10 million data.
Okay, see here, we are training the model.
Okay,
process of training the model and the process of doing a prediction in production, these two are the different processes. Whenever you are training the model, more is the data size, you opt for larger cluster for your quicker execution. Getting me? What cluster size I have selected, it's of two nodes only. If I have large data size, I would have selected cluster size of 5 nodes, 10 nodes. Okay, and there I would have seen the processing is happening in lesser time. Mm-hmm. Okay, so this is one thing. Now here, whenever you have 10 million records, you need a larger cluster where every node should have a fairly good hardware. Number of CPUs, larger RAM, larger storage. Okay, in production, things are different. In production, if it is a real-time prediction where single record is submitted, okay, it is analyzed and its prediction is sent back to the user, okay, there you need small size of cluster because there you are not submitting billions of and millions of record at a time. But that production environment will keep getting the prediction request.
Okay.
need that large hardware in production, okay, but still that hardware should be scalable. That's why in the production environment we use Kubernetes. Mm-hmm. Have I answered your question?
Yes. Thank you, sir.
Yes, yes. Anybody? One follow-up is, can we also train more than two models at a time and also one the same data with a different data transformation steps? You will have to design multiple data pipelines. Okay, and then what you can do is, now here you know this evaluate model where you do comparison, it takes only two inputs. So in designer, you know, they are giving you evaluate model with two inputs only. Okay, I will come back to answer your question because now execution has been done. I am going to score the model. Okay, and in score the model, output of score the model, if you want to see, just a minute. See here, score labels 0.65. Now this is the loan status it has calculated. Why it has calculated the status in figures, I mean to say 0.65, because I have selected regression model. Had I selected classification model, it would have shown me 0 or 1. 0 for most probably the customer will be defaulter, and 1 for most probably the customer will return the loan. Okay, so as I have selected regression, now it is showing me such figure. So this is a data of test. Sorry, this figures it has calculated from the test data. Train data it has used for training the model, and test data it has used for calculating the performance of the model. Now I go to evaluate model, and in evaluate model, let us see what it shows to me. Okay, it shows to me the performance of the model. Okay, so root mean square error 0.40. Coefficient of determination 0.18. Model is not good. Model what I have selected is not good. Okay, but the point is, I can come to know the performance of the model from here. Okay, so somebody asked me about ROC curve. Had I selected for classification, I would have seen that information here, and I would have seen those factors here. Okay, but here I can see the performance of the model. So that's how, you know, we design the pipeline. Okay, and once we design the pipeline, okay, any question up to this? Let me just check so that we can think of moving ahead. Our own model using Python and invoke that model in the designer. Yes, it is possible. So in case if you have an algorithm of which the equivalent algorithm is not available here, okay, we can do that. We can design, submit our own model, okay, from here. Let me just show you. Python language, R language. So from here also we can submit our own models. That is possible. Create Python model. Custom script. Okay, so from here you can do that. Any other question? Can we create one? Also one the same data with a different, okay. Fine. The next step is, now I want to publish this model as a REST service. Okay, so here is an option. Okay, I can publish it as a real time. In this case, you know, it will create REST endpoints for the model. One endpoint from where it will take the input for the prediction, and another endpoint through which it will send a response, actual prediction. So that is real-time endpoint where it will create a REST endpoints for us. Batch inference pipeline means it will create endpoints from where we can submit the data set to it. So I may have not a single record coming from the customer, but some branch did not have the internet, so they added all these inquiries of the loan into one file, and that file they have submitted. Okay, and now we want to do the prediction on those hundreds of records. So there we will go with a batch inference. In this batch inference, you have to submit the data as a new data set. We have to submit the data as a new data set. I go with a real-time inference pipeline as of now. And what it will do, it will create a new pipeline now. So now it is in process of creating a new pipeline. And in this new pipeline, just see, there is one web service input, sorry, web service output. Here you will get the REST response, and there is web service input where you will have to submit your REST data. So what it has done is, the rest of the steps it has kept as they are. Some of the steps they might have changed, okay, but it has added two new activities here. One is web service input and another is web service output. Okay, once you have done it, finally I have to submit it once before I do the deployment. Okay, so that I can submit from here. Okay, so I click on the submit, and then this model will be ready for the purpose of the deployment. So in the same Chandra EXPR, I run it. Okay, and now it will take a little longer time for validating whole pipeline. Okay, it will validate whole pipeline. Okay, and it will make that pipeline ready for the purpose of the deployment. Okay, and then we can start the deployment. In the meantime, let me just check. Is it possible to do AutoML, or AutoML has another option here. This is designer. This I can use to register the model. Okay, and if you want to do model creation through AutoML, then there is a different approach. In this approach, here I have created a single model. I can create two models and do the comparison in designer, but in AutoML, it creates n number of models and gives me complete matrix of the performance of each and every model. And there then I can deploy best performing model in automated ML. So automated ML approach, is really automated in the sense that it gives me very little type of customization. It will decide which hyperparameters to apply. It will apply algorithms. It will apply ensembling and all those cross validations and all those, everything it will automatically apply and will give me really best performing model. That is AutoML. Okay. I will not be able to show you complete deployment, because complete deployment will take much more time. Okay, but I will just guide you through some of the steps. After deployment, if we need to retrain the model due to reduced model performance of change in the input data, can we add any step in designer to make the model retrain based on, let's say, if model performance reduces over time to a certain value, then I understood your question, but I think that is a little bit different area, and that is ML ops. It goes into ML ops, in which whatever be the your logged data you want to resubmit, okay, so that you can do, and that automation you can do through ML ops. So that is possible. But that is possible through ML ops. What are the options in Azure ML for model management, like versioning? Versioning happens automatically. So here, if you go, okay, now it is done. It is done. let me do one thing. I will have to do the deployment. Okay, but when I do the deployment, what was the question? Versioning, no? Okay. So I go to the say model list. Now, yet it is not populated here, but whenever multiple models are created from one pipeline, you know, automatically those are versioned, incremental versions under the same name. So that will appear here, that model will appear here. Okay, but first of all, let me start the deployment. So for the purpose of the deployment, okay, what I have to do is I will have to create another compute. Okay, now let me just show you different types of computes here. Again, in order to run our designer pipeline, we understood compute cluster. In order to do the deployment, I have to go to inference cluster. I have to create inference cluster from here. Okay, and there were two choices earlier, container instances, ACI, and AKS. AKS is Kubernetes service. As of now, it is providing you single choice and it is Kubernetes service. So size of the Kubernetes cluster and all that thing you can submit here. Okay, I mention East US 2. Oh, here it is. Okay, and then what kind of nodes should we choose? What should be the size of the cluster? All those things I will have to submit here. Okay, the point what I want to bring to your notice is, okay, once we make this cluster ready, now this is the production cluster. This is the production cluster. Okay, I just do not select it and I just do not submit it, but otherwise it will take next 15 minutes, you know, for creating the cluster. I don't have that much time as of now. Okay, so this is I am canceling. Okay, so once we create this Kubernetes cluster, then we can choose this and we can, you know, submit that pipeline for the deployment, because whenever I am submitting that pipeline for the deployment, here is the pipeline. Okay, I want to submit for the deployment, and when I submit it, it does ask me for the cluster. As I haven't created a cluster, you know, I cannot do the deployment, but otherwise I can submit the pipeline. And once that model is deployed on the Kubernetes cluster, when that model is deployed on the Kubernetes cluster, you can see endpoints created here. You will see endpoints created here. These are REST endpoints. And yes, one more thing you can see here, that these endpoints, if you want to test, you can do the testing of these endpoints from here. So from this browser, it will create a REST services to submit the data. So it will ask you the data to submit, and it will show you the prediction. So you can do that testing also from here. Not only that, it will give you the code in Python, in R, in Scala. That code you have to copy paste into your web application. Okay, and that code can create a REST request from your web application to connect to your model. That will take next say half an hour to 45 minutes. Okay, but somehow I'm just, you know, explaining you the steps that it is possible.
Hello, sir.
Yes, one by one.
Yes, Manisha, you can go for it.
Yes, actually we are exceeding our time. So we can winding up this session now.
Yes. Okay, sir. Yes. Okay.
Rupesh, you can proceed.
Yes, sir. I'll take from here. So everyone, I'll request everyone to just hold their questions, because we will be keeping one special session at the end of this month, and that will be handled by our subject matter expert, SMEs. So during that session, you can ask any technological question that you have. Those announcements will be done on our social media channel. So I'll request everyone to do follow us on social media. So once again, thank you so much, Chandrasekhar sir, for this wonderful session on DP100. And thank you everyone for attending this webinar. I'll just request everyone just hold for 5 more minutes. I'll be real quick. I just want to make few announcements once again for you guys. So just be here. Just a moment. I'm just sharing my screen. So I hope my screen is visible. Please confirm if there's an issue. Please do let me know.
Yes, yes, visible, Rupesh.
Yes. So this is the special announcement for the our next CERT Ready webinar. So the topics will be DA 100, that is happening on 3rd July. Session will be in the morning. Again, the second one will be on 24th July. Topic will be at PL 100. Again, the session will be in the morning. As we have said at the start of this session, we are simultaneously running two different webinar series. One is CERT Ready and the other is ETT, that is Emerging Technology Training. So here is the session calendar for ETT. And the next ETT webinar that is happening on 10th of July. And the topic is DevSecOps with the Azure DevOps. Okay, so you can join us in the morning. All the announcements will be done on our social media, as well as we'll be sharing the registration link for these sessions in the chat box. Please do follow them. This special announcement, once again for you, that your feedbacks are important to us. So do share us the feedback. And out of those feedbacks, we are going to select 5 lucky winners. And those are going to get the Microsoft-sponsored exam vouchers with which you can attempt any of Microsoft examination for free of cost. So I assume you all are active on LinkedIn, because the next announcement is connected with your LinkedIn profile. So now one lucky winner could win Microsoft's Surface laptop every month. And for that, all you have to do is just update your skills on your profile. So there is 2 sections that are available under your profile section. One is skills and endorsement, and another is certification, license and certification. So either you can do one of them, or you can update both the things. You can update your skills by adding the new technology that you have adopted recently. So as after the session, you can add a DP, DP 100 and all the technologies connected with that. And along with, if you have done any certification recently and you haven't updated it on your profile, so please do it. These are the steps that you need to follow to get your badge on your LinkedIn. And with that, you have to follow one link. Okay, you have to submit once the update's been done. So the link has been given in a feedback form. So once you'll open the feedback form, you'll find it at the last section. There's a link. You have to click there and you have to submit the updated profile, and then you will be enrolled with this raffle contest. Here is the social media present. You can follow us on the social media handles, and there you will be updated with the all the technology knowledge, and our upcoming webinars, meetups, and everything will be announced there. So do follow us, guys. One last important thing for this session, the recording will be uploaded on our YouTube channel. So I'll request once again everyone to just subscribe to our official channel. We'll be sharing the link in the chat box to follow that. Once again, thank you so much for attending this session. We'll see you in the next webinar. Have a great weekend, everyone. Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you, Rupesh. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.